All my dear friends in Christ Jesus, once again welcome back to our studies on 1 Timothy chapter 3 verses 8 onwards. In the previous class, we have meditated upon the qualifications of a minister in a local church, of his personal qualifications, his family qualifications and his church qualifications. This evening, we would like to share with you about the New Testament deacons and also about the New Testament church, the New Testament deacons and New Testament church. As a way that we have learned about the ministries of the local church, so we have been spoken about the deacons and a deaconess in an early Christian church. Regarding the deacons, certain qualifications of their ministry is also assigned here in this session. First of all, we read the word likewise, that means which indicates that God has equally important standard for the deacons, for he is working with the pastor in guiding his ministry and also shepherding the local sheep. Concerning them, it says that they must be grave, means they must be serious in their outlook, their actions, as well as in their dispositions. They should be held in high respect. That means a deacon must be always held in high respect. He should not be a double-tongued. The word double-tongued means a person, a talebearer, the one who says one thing to one person and yet another thing to another person. Such a person is known as a talebearer. A deacon or a minister of a local congregation should never be involved himself in talebearing, or he should not be a double-tongued person. The church leaders must be people who keep their word. That means whatever they present before the congregation, they ought to fulfill what they have outspoken. The matters of wine and money were discussed in verse number 3. There may be the warning as in 11 against misusing the church fund by these deacons, because the main business of deacons in the assembly were keeping the accounts of the church and also looking after the worldly affairs mainly. They also had to assist the ministers, elders in the local church of their spiritual activities. Some translate verse number 11 as deaconess. Probably this must be speaking about the wives of those deacons or ministers, but it is not exactly clear from the text. We have no clear evidences in the New Testament that the early church had deaconess as well as deacons, but it is assumed. And most probably, the scholars of the Bible, they have opinion that this phrase is speaking about the wives of those elders by the word deaconess. Now, verse number 14 to 16, which are seriously talking about the New Testament church. The New Testament church, as we have discussed before, it has two aspects, universal aspect and local aspects. Universal church is known as the universal body of Christ or the bride of Christ. It can be interpreted as both the body of Christ and the bride of Christ, which comprised all born-again believers of all ages. That means all ages means from the day of Pentecost till the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ from heaven. All those people who have personally received the Lord Jesus Christ into their heart as their own personal Savior and Lord, beginning from the day of Pentecost, ending by the coming of Christ from heaven to receive his own. So these people are the members of the universal church, otherwise the body of Christ. Here Apostle Paul is talking about not how to walk in the universal church, but the emphasis here is the local church. So he is writing here, local church, and the local church is just as much the true church as the mystical body of Christ. All the instructions are given to practice not in the universal church, but in the local church. Universal church is a mystic body or mystery body where we cannot do any specific ministries. So all the ministries and the ministries are assigned to the local church, which is the visible manifestation of universal church. So first aspect, universal church, which is invisible, and its members are following from past, present and the future, whereas the local church is having only born-again Baptist members of the current time who are connected to the body of Christ by personal faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Here, Paul is talking about that mystical body of Jesus Christ, which is a universal church, which is quite invisible, but the manifestation of the universal church appears as local churches everywhere. Paul gives us here several images to this church. Number one is the house of God. The Bible speaks the church as a house of God. We know that in a house, father is the head and a mother take care of the children in subjection to the husband's authority or father's authority. Father's authority is well explained in a Christian house or any houses. The same way, church as a house of God, God is in authority of the church. Therefore, we read from the Word of God, the churches of Jesus Christ, or churches of God, church of God or church of Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 6 verse 10 and Ephesians 2:19 further explains this meaning. Paul wrote this letter to teach people how to behave as members of God's family. We are all the members of the family of God in heaven. So, we have been assigned or we have been exhorted to behave properly in the family of God as dear children of God. So, the first image which is discussed here regarding the church is church as a house of God. So God the Father is the owner of this house and Christ is the ruler of this house, and then we the believers are in total sublime submission and subjection to the authority of Jesus Christ. Therefore we say that every local church is autonomous in itself and itself, and when we say that it is all having the autonomy. We understood that it is under the subjection and control of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the owner of the church. The second image is given here is the pillar and the ground of truth. Pillar and the ground of truth. Both the words are coming from an architectural language. Paul uses the athletic languages, the architectural languages, military languages, and many more languages in his whole writings. Here he uses these architectural languages. Church is what holds up God's truth in this world. So actually the word ground means bulwark or foundation. And in one translation I have read that it renders as basement. The word ground means basement. So basement is actually the two. As a local church is faithful to preserve, preach and practice the truth of God's word, the God's work prospers on earth. So the pillar and the ground of truth is very important when we study about the church of Jesus Christ. And thirdly, the third image is the body of Christ. So we have the house of God, the pillar and ground of truth, and then finally, the body of Christ. Verse number 16, perhaps an early Christian hymn memorized by the saints for the worship service. We do not know exactly, it might be. But it says the mystery of godliness is God's hidden program to bring godliness into the world. God had a hidden program in his mind down right from the beginning. And that program brings godliness into the world. Of course, Christ is God's great mystery. Our Lord Jesus Christ is God's great mystery, and this song exalts him. His birth, his death, his burial, his resurrection, everything. So it has preliminarily has to do with the earthly ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. So actually, the Lord Jesus Christ, or God in his person Jesus Christ, he had begun the work in the local church right from the beginning, and now the saints continues the work which he began. That is what the Bible says. The church on this earth is the body of Christ on earth, where Paul is speaking of local church and not the universal church. So church on the earth is the body of Jesus Christ. So we should have reverence to God and his word when we learn about the church of Jesus Christ, because we read that the New Testament preaches us the house of God, the pillar and ground of truth, and finally as the mystic body of Jesus Christ. Today we have so much of prejudices as to sectisms promoting Brethren or Pentecostals or Baptists, the New Testament pattern church, and they are the only people who belong to God. It's a wrong ideology. The Bible says all who have personally confessed their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and have accepted him into their heart as their own personal Savior and Lord, irrespective of caste, color, nationality and religion, they are the members of the body of Jesus Christ, and they all comprised this functional organism. Church as a universal body, Jesus Christ is his head. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and Romans chapter 12, Apostle Paul will explain this phenomena, where it says that Christ controls the body. That means as head is controlling station for the body and its function, Christ is the controlling station from whence the body stands in proper functioning. So we have the house of God, the pillar and ground of truth, and finally the body of Christ. Always remember, when we gather together in the local church to worship God, that it is the visible manifestation of the universal church which Christ has established by his precious death on the cross of Calvary, by the shedding of his blood. So we need to understand that the local church, though it is small in its appearance and it is confined to a specific location, but still it is the manifestation of the universal church, and all the qualifications and qualities mentioned for the universal church must be importantly and equally kept up, must be keeping up in the local church, because the local church is not lessened than the universal concept. Only the universal church differs in one thing, that it is invisible church, which the members of which is falling from past, present and future, whereas the local church comprises only its current born again members. May God bless all of you by the meditation of this short video, the hearing of 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 14 to 16. May God's blessings be showered on you, God willing, that we will be meeting again in our study of the same subject from chapter 4 of 1 Timothy in the next session. May God's name be glorified. Thank you.